So good afternoon, everybody. And Steve, this is a real pleasure and honor for me. So how's Xposure going?
Fantastic so far. It's been amazing. I'd like to thank His Highness for this incredible hospitality. I think this is one of the great photo events in the world. It's just the meticulous attention to detail. Also, the Xposure team has been really great. So it's a great experience. Look forward to coming back.
Excellent. Well, I've got a lot of responsibility on my shoulders here because I know that every single person in this audience knows your work incredibly well. And I'm just trying to double guess the questions that they'd want to ask if they were sitting here. So what I intend to do is just start at the very beginning. So you and your teens, you had a travel lust, a wanderlust. Tell us about that.
Well, my ambition really from a very early age was to travel. I remember visiting my grandmother. She had this big stack of Life magazines, and I used to kind of pore over them. And I came across this one issue in like 1962. It was a photo essay by Brian Brake. He was a wonderful photographer from New Zealand. He did a story on the monsoon. And I remember looking at each picture thinking, this is a magical place, and the drama of all that rain, I want to go there and experience that for myself. So, you know, fast forward 20 years or 25 years, I went back and lived through a couple of monsoons and decided to do a story on it.
But you also went to film school, right?
Yeah, I went to film school. I wanted to make documentaries, make films. As I was studying it, I realized it was a lot more complicated than I thought it was going to be. You know, it required a team, a sound man, camera operator, and all this. And in the middle of that course, I took a fine art photography class. And I discovered the world of photography, the solitary quality of wandering around on your own and discovering things. So I decided that maybe this was more suited to my personality. Walking out the door, it was a lot more affordable. Things were unscripted. You could just kind of wander here and wander there. And I just decided I want to go in that direction. And I had, when I was 19, I lived in Europe for a year and then went over to Turkey through Eastern Europe. And I thought, you know, whatever I do in my life, I want travel to be a part of it. I want to see the world. I want to experience everywhere, Africa, Asia, South America, parts of the US, Canada. I just want to see it all. And learn about cultures and different kinds of music and food and architecture. So that was really what I was, my main ambition was at that age.
So when I was putting this together, I heard a quote that you gave in an interview a few years ago, and you called your career path a solitary endeavor because you realized that, you know, you wanted to do this on your own. You didn't want to go with a film crew. You didn't want a production company with you. Tell us about why it became a solitary endeavor and how that progressed.
Well, when you're alone, when you're in this solitary process, you're able to follow your own nose, stop where you want to, linger, maybe spend having a coffee or a tea somewhere in somebody's home. You don't have that pressure of a production or a team. So I thought I would do better work. Get up when you want to, go to bed when you want to. So it was kind of tell the kind of stories that you want to tell. That's kind of what the direction I wanted to go in.
And then when did you realize that, you know, you had this travel lust, you wanted to travel, but when did you have that moment where you realized, well, actually, if I become a photographer, that's going to allow me, as it says here, this is going to be my passport to follow my passion, which is to travel. So when did you realize, wait a second, if I can take pictures and I can sell these pictures, I can follow my dream, which is to travel? Was that like a sudden a light bulb going off?
I think it was sort of halfway through my university years, wondering, you know, where do I go, what do I do? Started working on a newspaper. That was okay for a year or two. It got kind of monotonous, repetitive, being dispatched here, dispatched there. And the kind of assignments weren't very interesting. And I thought, you know, I got to escape right. from this and actually do my own thing and go in my own direction.
And you bought a one-way ticket to India?
One-way ticket to India with about 80 rolls of Kodachrome.
Right, okay. And while you were in India, you met some people, you went to Pakistan, to the northern border, and you met some people that were telling you about something that was going on in Afghanistan, right?
Yeah, I was trying to escape the heat of the monsoon. So I crossed over into Pakistan, went up into the Hindu Kush, up into Chitral, just hanging out, met some refugees literally living in the next room of my hotel, got to talking, you know. And they said, yeah, there's a war going on in our country. And, you know, you're a photographer. We'd like to take you in and tell that story. The last thing I thought I want to do would be go into a war zone. And especially without a passport. I thought this isn't a good idea, but you know, I was there for a week or 10 days, and we kept talking, and they explained, no, trying to persuade me to go in, we'll take you through the mountains, and I eventually thought, okay, well, if we just go in, I'll take it as it comes, and I went in and stayed for 3 weeks.
But now, here you are in the middle of a war that is suddenly being recognized as a serious issue and is being recognized by the West. And you're in the right place at the right time. And now suddenly, photographs that you have, that you've taken, are being required by the Western media. So how did you get those pictures? We're talking black and white, there's no digital here. You are in the middle of Afghanistan during a war. How did you get those pictures out?
Well, I had to cross back into Pakistan just by walking through the mountains alone. They dropped me at the border, top of the mountain, and they said, go that way. So I thought, I'm going to take some film and some dummy film. I'm going to put it in my camera bag and kind of rewind it a bit so that if they want to confiscate my film. But the film that I exposed, I kind of opened up the seam of my shalwar kameez and my vest that I was wearing, and I slipped the film into various parts of my shalwar kameez. And I thought after walking through these mountains for 3 weeks, the last thing I want is somebody to, so I had to cross the border and then get a bus and a train. I went from Chitral all the way to Delhi.
And then you finally got these pictures back, and they were published in the New York Times.
Yeah, I gave the film to a friend of a friend.
Right.
to take back. Right. And so the film, the first trip was in June of 1979, and they weren't published until September of that year. So months were going by.
79.
Nobody wanted the story. Nobody wanted the pictures. But then when eventually the kind of caught, and then when the Russians invaded the Soviet Union invaded in December of 79, all hell broke loose.
Right.
And suddenly, you know, everybody wanted pictures. And so pictures that were already at that point several months old,
right,
were popping up all over the place.
But they were the only ones available because you were.
In the beginning, there were very few photographers. Right. There were a few, photographers here and there. Mm-hmm. But I had probably spent more time than most photographers.
And clearly you spoke fluent Pashto, right?
Oh, I still speak Pashto, Dari, a little bit of Urdu. No, I'm joking. I had to rely on an Afghan translator who spoke a bit of English. I picked up a few words of Pashto, but it's so when you're basically deciding to go this way or that way, you know, bombs are falling and you're being shot at, and you can't quite understand what the situation is, mm-hmm. and which way to go. It gets it's disconcerting, to say the least.
So that probably was your big break, and it elevated you as a photographer, and you were then getting noticed. And in 1980, you won the Robert Capa Gold Medal, which is, if you don't know it, is the medal that's given for exceptional courage and enterprise, and normally goes to conflict photographers. And over the years, some of the great conflict photographers have won this award. But you didn't want to be a conflict photographer as such.
Well, my interest was more about culture and people and human behavior, how people lived, how people related to the environment and animals and each other. And I wanted Tibet. I was interested in going to Tibetan regions, you know, Bhutan, Ladakh. That was really what I was mostly fascinated with.
And at this stage, were you now convinced this is it, this is what I'm doing for the rest of my life? I just can't think of doing anything else.
Oh, I from day one, I never looked back. I never had, literally from that moment to, I never thought, well, maybe I'll do something else. Maybe I'll be sell Afghan carpets or something. No, I never for a moment thought of anything else.
So there was never any question. The passion was there.
No question.
And
there was do or die.
So at that age, and you've been into Afghanistan, you've covered this, you've got some great photographs that are getting published all around the world. Did the young Steve McCurry know that he was going to be the Steve McCurry we see in front of us today? Did you know you could keep getting better and get to that level where, you know, we're looking at black and white photographs here that are great, that would still look great today if they were being sent out of Afghanistan. But you kept going to higher and higher levels. Was it in you then? Did you know that you were capable of that?
I don't think I ever really thought about that. I think that, you know, if you really work hard, you have a passion, you love what you're doing, you hone your craft to a fine point, year after year, decade after decade, you start to learn a few things. I think when I see a young photographer, I say, come back after you've made another 50,000 exposures or whatever. Right. I think within time, if you remain a student and you're always willing to learn, look at good work, and try and, again, improve your game, I think that you just get better. You get, dissatisfied with some of the things you've done in the past, and you want to do better. I think I think back trying to shoot with Kodachrome was like impossible. It was so exacting. The exposure had to be bang on. And, I think about shooting in low light at 64 ISO. It's like, forget it. It's impossible.
So here you are. You're sitting in the mountainside with a mujahideen. You've got a camera and a bag of film. And that's it. You don't know what's on that film. You can't see it. It's not digital. It's just going to go back. Anything could happen between it leaving your camera and arriving in the dark room. But it worked out. And then, suddenly,
well,
you start a new journey.
Yeah, I had gone to India. That was my first sort of big trip. And I, within a couple of weeks, I had come in contact with a rabid dog. and at the same time was suffering from dysentery. And I had to drag myself out of my bed and go to the doctor to get these painful shots in my stomach. I thought I was going to die. But in the middle of all that, I read this book by Paul Theroux called The Great Railway Bazaar. And I had been already traveling by train. And I thought, this is a magical piece of writing. And I thought, this would make a great set of pictures. And I thought, I'm going to do that, as I travel around, I'm going to photograph, and I actually, that's what I did, so, you know, and I spent weeks and weeks on the train going all over the place.
I mean, an image like this, you know, where obviously you're using the right shutter speed to get that sense of movement and so on, so you're framing these things in camera.
Well, the door was locked between the restaurant car and where we were sitting. And we had ordered some tea, or people were getting breakfast. And my assistant said, you're not going to believe this, but they're passing the trays on the outside of the train. So I thought, oh, my God, that's amazing. So I actually leaned out. I had him hold my knees. It was the first day I was working with this guy.
Right.
And I was thinking, if it had been any longer, he probably would have let me go.
Let you go.
You know, but he... on my knees, like made literally, I don't know, 3 or 4 frames. And
there's a lovely quote from you, which was, the Indian station is a theater.
Oh.
Wow. I mean, all of life.
Yeah, 30 years ago. I mean, everybody went by train. I mean, nobody flew. Nobody drove. Maybe some people took the bus. But train was the way to travel. And there were literally... you know, hundreds of millions of people traveling by train.
And when you see an image like this, I mean, it's just so incredibly well composed. I mean, it couldn't be any better. I mean, the colorways, just the way that the subject is always looking at you, always making eye contact with people. And quite often, I guess, they're just looking at you wondering who you are. It's like, who is this Westerner guy standing on the platform taking pictures on me? But, I mean, moments like that, do you think of them in advance? Do you go along and you see that and you think, if I keep going on this one, this is really going to make a great frame?
Well, I was, every time the train stopped in a station, which was every few minutes or every half an hour or whatever, I would get out of the train and photograph the passengers from in the windows, and also the people getting on and getting off, the vendors selling, you know, chai or whatever they were selling. And I did that hundreds and hundreds of times, all, you know, night, day. So it was, so the people would, if they were going to market, they'd strap their bicycles on the side of the train.
Right.
And then go to market, get a free ride. Mm-hmm. And then either come back, I don't know, maybe they, but they were going 20 miles.
So this is only part of the journey. They're going to continue the journey on their bicycles. So this is Agra Station. And when you visited this, how many times did you go and scope this out to look at the light and work out what was the best time to do it? How did you approach that? When you know there's something special there, how much detail do you go into? How many times would you go and replay that until you get the right light and the right atmosphere?
Well, before I was wondering if the train went anywhere near, in any kind of proximity to the Taj. And when I got to Agra, I realized not only does a train sort of pass within several hundred meters from the Taj, there's an entire railroad yard.
Right.
With, I don't know, maybe a dozen engines. And so there was a lot of traffic in that road. Not only that, but there was another station, which was just a 10 or 15-minute walk.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so these two were like a 15-minute walk. So I spent about 5 days shuttling between the Taj
and
the station. And then in the early morning... people, they had these Dhobi ghats where they would wash clothes underneath the bridge. So I would check what time the train would come. I got the schedule, and I was ready when the train came across. Sometimes it came on time, sometimes it didn't. But it was all about, you know, checking the schedule and being in the right place.
So there's a lot of research. I mean, you're really thinking this through, because, I mean, this looks like it could be a Merchant Ivory production. It looks like there could be an entire film crew here with somebody shouting action and so on. And to me, this kind of really does give a great kind of visual reference to India. Sitting in that chair is, who's being...
That's the rail inspector. Some of the tracks in that area have been ripped up now. They no longer exist.
Right.
And the steam locomotives are all gone as well. So it's kind of a piece of history now, because if you go back to that spot, there's houses and buildings and trees and all kinds of things you can't even recognize.
So your images are documenting history as well. I mean, mm-hmm. this is never going to happen again. We're never going to see this again. Right. And just the fact that these three guys are pushing along the station house. Didn't you tell me that you were trying to get permission for this and it arrived?
So I had gone to the Ministry of Railroads in Delhi and tried to explain, I want to do this story. Oh, yeah, that's great. No problem. We'll be happy to do that. And a month goes by, another month goes by, and I kept working, and I was almost done with, and then they gave me my permit. I was like done with the shoot when the permissions came through. I just went ahead and...
and here you are at the station, your theater, waiting for it all to take place. So your love of India, I mean, for those of us who've been to India, and especially at this time, when the first time you arrive, there's this incredible cacophony of noise and smell and chaos, but it all comes together. Is this what you fell in love with? Was the just the vibrancy of the place?
Well, it's such a rich culture. You have all these different religions swirling around, and you have ultra, you know, rich people, or poor people, people living in an ancient way, people living in a modern way, people everywhere. It was just, it's visually rich, and a lot of sort of chaos on the street.
Right.
It's just things happening all over. You know.
But again, we were talking yesterday, and we were saying about, you know, you see things, and then you think, oh, that would make a great photograph. But you don't have that luxury of thinking back. You looked at this is what, in a taxi from the airport to the hotel, and there's this incredible moment where you're framing this woman and her child, and the heat outside, and the AC in your car. Stunning image, and this is just in seconds. How many frames do you think you got?
Two.
Two frames.
Well, I have this one, and the boy looked over to his mother. Boom, that was it.
Right.
I had literally not slept the night before. I was up for various reasons. And I was on my way in the neighborhood of the airport, and they came up, and I actually forgot I had made this picture, but there were like just literally just two frames.
Right, it is the most extraordinary picture, and amazing cities. So I got to be honest with you that, you know, I know how modest you are, but you've inspired countless thousands of photographers, myself included. Who were your inspirations? Who were your heroes as you were starting out?
Well, I think you'd have to mention Henri Cartier-Bresson, of course. I think people like André Courtège and Walker Evans and Dorothea Lang, they're all, I think Ernst Taus was an incredible color photographer. They were some of the people that I followed as a
So you were studying the masters that went before you and looking at how they
endlessly,
approached things.
Yeah. Endlessly. And I was in school we would look. I'd pore over these photography books. I remember looking at a book by Elliot Erwitt, and just turning every page, just amazed, and looking at his work, his life, and places he went to. I did a workshop with Elliot in 1975, and you know, just an inspiring, you know, great photographer.
Right. And I'd like to pause on this image for a moment, because I mean, I think for me, it's almost a perfect image. I mean, you know, the colorways, just the way it's composed, and the little boy, both feet off the ground as he's running, you've captured that moment. But you told me the story about this, that you kept going back to this place. This is after Holi, right, after the festival. Tell us the story about how this picture came about.
Well, I spent on this, I'd been to Jodhpur many times, but on this particular trip after Holi, and they had the, I was walking around and came across this alleyway. I don't know what the first person coming or going, I framed it. And it was a major kind of thoroughfare through this neighborhood. I kept shooting, different people crossing. And I thought, this is, and I started looking at it closer, realizing you had this ochre wall, the window, the hands, and people as they came in and out of the frame really completed the composition.
Mm-hmm.
I shot it, and then I wandered off. And then I guess that night, I was looking through my pictures, it's a digital picture, and I thought, well, that's really interesting. So I thought, I better go back there again tomorrow and keep working. So I went back for, I don't know, maybe another hour and a half or something. Maybe not completely focused on the scene, but just sort of, that's where I was, and I would shoot around and keep shooting that alleyway. And eventually...
It's one of my favorite frames. I think it's absolutely amazing. And again, this, the composition. I mean, this is all in camera.
Kodachrome.
This is Kodachrome. There's no room for error. If you're half
it's
a
dark.
Stop out, you're in trouble.
Yeah, you're sort of wide open at maybe, if you're lucky, 125th of a second.
And the richness of it is just extraordinary. And his eyes, I mean, I just think it's such a powerful image. And again, this, the composition here, this was at a wedding?
Yeah, I attended a wedding. Again, it's in Jodhpur. So there were different floors and different activities. And this staircase was on the way to the roof.
Mm-hmm.
So I had been up and down, and, you know, and I just waited on this one particular landing and
mm-hmm.
waited for something to happen.
But when you're looking through the viewfinder and you've composed this and it's beautifully composed, and the little boy is running up the stairs, but you don't know you've got that picture.
No.
Not until you get back and you get those Kodachromes back, you know you've got that. So it's unlike just looking at the back of your camera. I mean, I think that's what really just is mind-blowing in your approach to photography, that you can see this and capture this in that instant. And then we were talking earlier about your mobile studio that you travel around the world with. Tell everybody about the mobile studio have.
Well, I was doing the last roll of Kodachrome project. I got the last roll from Kodak. And I wanted to photograph iconic places and people. And I thought, what better iconic place or people was a vanishing way of life? These Rabari, semi-nomadic people in Rajasthan and Gujarat. So this is he's a magician from mm-hmm. the Rabari tribe. And I was on this friend's farm, and he came up at 11 o'clock in the morning. I thought, well, where can we make a portrait of this guy? So there was a shed, literally a vacant shed. And we photographed him in that shed. And it looks like there's a studio with a backdrop and lights, and makeup and all. But it's the amazing thing for me is that there are people in the world that look like this gentleman. Mm-hmm. I mean, for him and his tribe and his family and the people, I mean, he's dignified and handsome, and this is I just was happy to make a portrait of him that I thought was, you know, beautiful.
So moving on to another project, which was a fairly long-term project, and again, we're talking about that just recognizing that something is going to be important. And with this image, tell us about it. You were actually, it's just pre the monsoon, and you were about to set out on a monsoon project, and you were in a taxi, and then a dust storm came, correct?
Well, my first inclination was just to roll the windows up of the taxi and wait for the dust storm to pass. And then I thought, well, wait a minute, it's really dramatic out there. There's all this dust and wind, and people are scurrying around, all the wind's blowing. So I decided to get out and photograph. And then the question was, well, what am I gonna shoot? And because these dust storms don't last very long, maybe a few minutes.
Right.
It's like a heavy rain that doesn't last for very long. And I just, as I was kind of searching the landscape, I saw these are women that were working on the road as kind of day laborers. And they were just waiting, protecting themselves from all this wind and dust.
And then, you know, as the project for the monsoons carried on, you know, here we have a scene. And I was asking you, because here's this chap, he's literally up to his neck in water this in the street, and he's carrying something which is clearly a precious belonging because this is his livelihood, and he's smiling. Mm. Why is he smiling?
So I was on the street, this is in Porbandar in Gujarat, and I was there for in this flooded area for about 3 or 4 days. So I saw him coming down the street, and remember, this is before there was no electricity. People aren't playing games or on their phone. So everybody's hanging out of their windows on the roof. And so they see this foreigner with the camera. And as this guy was walking down the street, they said, hey, this guy's going to take your picture. You know, smile. And everybody's yelling and laughing and to kind of, you know, telling this guy. And I think he's is partly embarrassment, partly self-conscious. And in the same... it could have been even the same day. This dog, they had let him, the dog wanted to get out of the house. So, I mean, the owner opened the door and the dog went out on the street realizing, you know, and it's kind of a joke on the dog.
But how many countries, you went to quite a few countries to cover the monsoons. It wasn't just in India.
Yeah, Nepal and
Indonesia. And you put a lot of thought into those projects. I mean, you really have to know the timing. You have to know where to be at a certain time. There's a lot of research goes into it.
Well, generally, you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. You know, you hear about this, and you try and get there, it's over, you know. So it was a lot of frustration, but in the end, it kind of evened out.
And there's a little bit of a funny story about this, because this didn't get picked when the edit was coming back, and the editor...
Well, they thought the guy was grabbing his crotch.
So they didn't want to use the image.
But it's actually just pulling his pajamas up.
And this one, you have to do a double take, because, of course, she looks as if she's somehow standing at a white picket fence with a lawn. But this is, she's up to her waist in water, and this is in Indonesia.
Indonesia, yeah, it's kind of a duckweed. It's this very fine little leaves.
You have to do a double take to work out what's going on. And we were talking about light, and you don't like shooting in harsh light. You know, you look for a more subdued light, right? And this is very much...
Yeah, my brain doesn't work very well in bright daylight. I don't think... and again, it's just a personal thing. I think with color photography, at least my kind of color photography, I don't think it does for me so well in bright light. I like softer light. My eyes are very sensitive as well, so I prefer to work in kind of a dark situation.
And again, going back to the railways, you know, there's such an important lifeline for people. I mean, in the monsoon, this is the highest point, right? So the locals use it to...
Yeah, they walk from village to village. Right. The train here only passed, it was either once a day or twice a day.
Right.
So after, yeah.
And this must have been fun.
Well, the problem is when you're in a flooded street in a city, they have manholes, and you have to be careful that you don't step into a manhole. So you have to kind of shuffle around. You can't really step, you have to shuffle everywhere. The other thing which is kind of unmentionable is that how dirty the water is. I mean, it's disgusting.
Well, one can only imagine what else is floating in that in that water, but you can't think about that, right?
Well, in the night, I go back to my hotel and get this Dettol. It's kind of a disinfectant. I figured, you know, you gotta, you know, either you're all in, because I had started with waders and we're shooting from a boat. The only way to do it is to jump in,
right,
and really submerge yourself in it and say, you know what, if I get sick, if I die, well, that's just
hence the saying, you're all in.
Yeah,
this is it. And in your childhood, in your teens, you kind of had a fascination for Buddhism. And I remember you saying, there was a great quote, a candle can light 1,000 other candles. And that fascinated you about the religion. And this, just explain, you know, where this is and how you got that light so that it reflected out the gold. Tell us a little bit about where this is.
Well, I mean, this has been photographed, you know, many times, but I wanted to go there for myself, I wanted to see it for myself and shoot it my own way. I went there for 3 days.
Right.
There's a monastery, there's a village. And 2 of the 3 days, again, this was sort of during the monsoon, it was either heavy overcast or fog.
Right.
So I was almost ready to leave and come back another time, but like the last afternoon, it cleared. So I thought, okay, I'll shoot it 15, 20 minutes after sunset. They have these lights. The government has installed these lights around the area. So on the shadow side, it was lit by these big spotlights. And then the sky is balanced with, you know, that 20 minute after sunlight.
But how many hours did it take you to get to the right position and the right light?
Oh, I scoped out the right position fairly quickly.
Right.
It was just waiting for the right light, or any light at all. That I wanted some color in the sky,
mm-hmm.
not just...
But it's hours, not minutes, right? You're really spending time waiting for the right situation.
Yeah, several days. It was like 3 days.
Several days. So you know you're going to get this picture. You're just going to wait until you get it.
Well, I was either going to get it on this trip or I was going to come back another week and try again.
Right. We call that dedication. So, yeah. I mean, the Buddhist religion, I mean, apart from religion itself and the fascination with it, I mean, it is just so visual. Right. I mean, just the monks and the priests, the way of life. And that's why, you know, you've created so many extraordinary pictures with that as a background. And while we're looking at these, you know, a lot of your work at that stage of your life was on assignment. And you were working for magazines and newspapers and whoever else was going to help fund it. But that really, really wasn't how you wanted to work, right? I mean, you got to a point where you really wanted to be in control of your own work and your own destiny, right?
Well, I wanted to go to places that I wanted to go to and shoot in the way that I wanted to shoot. And if I decided it wasn't working, I could leave or I could stay longer. And if I wanted to go to a place and maybe just make portraits, or go to a place and just shoot maybe one monastery.
Mm-hmm.
I could do that and just do it my own way in my own time, and then find a way to include it in a book or an exhibition. So that's really, really what direction I kind of.
So you could control not only the assignment but your own edits, and you could do it at your own pace and so on. And that became very important to you and book publishing and so on. We were talking about this image and how important it is where, you know, old meets new, This is a Buddhist monk. Where was this?
This is in Bodh Gaya in Bihar. This right. is really where the Buddha was enlightened. He sat under the tree, the Bodhi tree, and this is the town. So there's a lot of Buddhists that come from all over the world to.
Right.
It's a place of pilgrimage.
And what time? What year was this roughly?
About 20 years ago.
About 20 years ago. So I guess one of the other things is, you know, when you were out there, you were a pioneer in many ways, you know, traveling and seeing these things. But now that everybody's a photographer and everybody can travel, it's a more of a global village. Is it harder for you to go out and find new things? Do you tend to go back and look at places you've been before to see how they've changed?
Well, I think it's always fun to go back to places and see how they've changed. Often you're disappointed because you have this sort of an idea of how it was, and you go back and it's changed, and sometimes for the worse. But it's also fun to go, you know, to obviously to new places and try and discover new things on your own.
And this image, I think we were saying this is a digital image, right? This is
yeah.
when you shift it. Because, again, imagine all of this scenario, trying to choreograph all of this and capture it, all of these elements going on and the two monks at the back. But you were able to see that digitally. So suddenly the magic of digital, you're actually looking at the back of the frame. Yes, I got it. The first time I saw this, I couldn't believe it. The first time I saw it, I just thought, I don't understand what's going on. How did you hear about this? How did you research this?
Well, I have a friend who is a doctor who spent a lot of time at the Shaolin Monastery in China. And there's many schools there, monks practicing different forms of martial arts. And he basically invited me to meet him there. And we went around to several of the different schools, and this was one of them.
I mean, I just think it's extraordinary. And the discipline, how long can they retain that position?
Not very long, but if you see what they do in their practice, it's just extraordinary, and they start from a young age, and it's just, you know, what the human body can put itself through, it's amazing. So this was a cook. I stopped at a monastery in Tibet. This was a cook, and I just thought, I mean, you know, how amazing is that? This guy's 7 foot something. And
extraordinary.
And I'm a pretty short guy, but this guy was tall.
So this almost takes us back full circle to, you know, the Robert Capa Gold Medal for working in a conflict zone. And here you are in the Gulf War, and you managed to get an embed, correct? But you weren't there necessarily to cover the conflict. What was your reasoning to try and get this embed?
Yeah, it was mostly the environmental sort of catastrophe which was unfolding, and the hundreds of oil wells which had been lit and just let to burn. And there's all these, you know, camels and horses and cows roaming around the oil fields looking either for food or water or a way to escape.
And I remember you saying that, you know, when you arrive at a story, you try your very best to get as much of the story you can into one image rather than a series of image and narrative. And that's clearly what's happening here. That says so much.
Well, the camels, as I was kind of following them, they were like black camels on a black, you know, everything was black. In fact, it was like night. And so I was following them. Apart from being in a minefield, they finally came across this patch of burning oil, and at the end, the picture was over by the time they got to the end of that.
So this was really depicting the the effect on
This nature. Is in Saudi Arabia, a place called Jebel, and there were thousands of birds, migratory birds, which had flying over the Gulf, and unfortunately landed in these lakes of oil, and they all perished. Most of them perished.
I mean, I was laughing about this earlier with you. I mean, this man's leg is on fire, right?
Yeah, he's leaning over trying to stamp out his foot, which would caught. And I was back, at these sort of scientists were checking, you know, the soil and whatever. And I was there with my sort of baseball cap and photo vest.
And they're all in heat-resistant clothing, and you're wearing a baseball cap.
Yeah.
Right. And you're on a 105 lens, which is only taking you, you know, literally a few feet away.
And burning my beard off.
That's called dedication. And this is a kind of apocalyptic scene. Did the horse was just wandering around?
Yeah, he was. We gave him some water, which is a little hard because all we had was a bottle of water. He drank most of it, and then we just had to drive off. I mean, there was nothing we could do.
Recognize this?
Yeah.
You do? So, clearly one of the most iconic photographs of all time, the most reproduced across many genres. But tell us a story about how and why this picture came about. Where were you and how did you see this girl? And why did you think she was going to make a strong picture?
I was in a refugee camp outside of Peshawar, Pakistan, wandering around. I had a permission from the camp to be there, photographing various activities. And I was on my way. I was actually leaving to go to lunch. And as I was kind of walking out of the camp, I heard voices coming from this tent. It was clearly young girls. So I went to the tent, talked to the teacher. And like, can I come in and see the class? And eventually I got in and I looked around. I saw her, and I knew right away that this was the only picture I really wanted to make in that. So I photographed some of the other students. I wanted to relax everybody and make, you know, so that they understood this was, you know, kind of ordinary, nothing special, just, you know. And so to photograph some of the other students, the teacher was helping, and so I came to her, and she at first had her hands up, and I was on a tripod with Kodachrome, crazy low shutter speed, and didn't know if I'm in focus. Everybody's running around, dust flying everywhere. All these other girls are laughing,
but you knew it was a strong frame.
Oh yeah, no. I was in the zone, but I made a few frames, and then she got up and, I mean, she didn't know anything about, you know, she just. Eventually just got up and walked away, and that was it. And I was I kind of almost forgot about. And then I, you know, later saw
it. But the power of this image was just not that it became one of the most iconic portraits of all time. This raised the awareness of millions of people to her plight. And so it instilled empathy in people that they realized that she was a refugee, and it raised an enormous awareness and funding.
Yeah, it raised a lot of money too. I think that the perseverance, her comes with a great dignity and fortitude, proud. I'm not going to be beaten down. I think all came together to give people a sense that Afghans were not going to bend to, because at this time there were thousands of villages in Afghanistan which were being decimated by the combination of the Soviet Union and the Afghan army. And there were literally millions of Afghans flooding out into Iran, into Pakistan, and other neighboring countries. And so this was became kind of a symbol, in a way, of hope and perseverance.
And knowing that this had that effect, what has your mission been? What is it you'd like your audience to see from your pictures? What is it you were trying to achieve all through your career by taking these photographs?
Well, I think seeing the humanity in each other, seeing the dignity in our fellow man. I mean, often there's all this prejudice and racism. I think if photography can be part of the conversation in a positive way, and we can help people learn about the world that we live in, I think that's great. I think that's positive. I think we want to try and show how people live and what they look like and be the empathetic.
And you were always very respectful of the people you were photographing. You were saying it's like a connection, like a trust, that you were photographing them because you felt they were going to be able to help their position and their plight.
Yeah, I always, the people that I photograph, I always want to, it's a collaboration. I want to make sure that they're happy to be photographed. Sometimes we try and send them pictures. Often you can't because they're living somewhere out of touch. But I want to give people a voice, a dignity, and show the humanity of people everywhere I travel to.
Right. The clock is ticking, but full disclosure, when I asked Steve's studio if they could send over a few iconic Steve McCurry pictures, they sent 1,500. And I spent many days editing it down to the 90 you've just seen, but are we allowed a couple more minutes? Because there's a couple of other things. For instance, you may not know that this was originally going to be the cover of the magazine, and it was only when the editor-in-chief stepped in that he said, nope, we're going to go with that one. And then there was a documentary. You went back to try and find Shabbat Gula, and that was how long ago now?
Oh, boy, that's, I don't know, 20, almost like 30 years ago.
Right.
Something like that, yeah.
Right.
So she's now, she had requested help in going to Italy.
Right. She lives in Rome now, I think, right?
Yeah. And so we tried to, everything we could do to help her and her family make that journey.
And history is about to repeat itself, as it often does. And we now know that the situation in Afghanistan, there is looming another refugee crisis. There is starvation on the horizon. But you went back to Afghanistan many times. How do you think this is going to play out now that the Taliban are back in control?
I think we don't know how it's going to play out. It's not looking promising at the moment. And you think back where we were sort of this time last year with schools and girls studying and education and people having enough to eat, and it's not going in the right direction.
Right.
So the only thing we do is hope that some of that money that is owned by Afghanistan can be given to people who need food and, clothing and whatnot.
I could actually carry this on for another 3 hours, but I think we probably need to wind it down. But I have two things I'd like to say. I mean, at this stage, you could quite happily sit on a beach with a cohiba and not do anything and just live the rest of your life.
Exactly what I'm planning to do. After Xposure, I'm going to go sit on a beach with a cold drink.
What keeps you going? What is it?
No. I think if you love what you do and you're passionate about your work, and you get pleasure from your craft, your art, your photography, it's something that you kind of, it's the creative energy that you need that helps you kind of move through life. And I can't imagine doing anything else but doing what I'm doing now. And it's just what I love to do. So I'm going to continue doing it until I eventually die with my boots on, like Richard Avedon. Just one day you're, you know, out there working and you just keel over.
Outside on the wall, the beautiful exhibition you have, it describes you as one of the most iconic voices in contemporary photography. What would the young Steve McCurry think about that, the 19-year-old that started traveling the world? Did you ever think that was going to be the case?
No, I think he would think that was... I think he'd get a laugh out of that.
Did you aspire to that originally?
No. I my ambition was to travel. I mean, life is short. We get like one chance. And what is more important? How can you spend your life? I think that for me, traveling, seeing the world, seeing what the world has to offer, meeting wonderful people, what else am I going to do? Right. What else? So to me, that this is like the perfect solution to how it works for me. It might not work for somebody else, but I think I've made the best use of my time.
Right.
And I'm just going to continue.
Okay. Well, Steve McCurry, one of the most iconic voices in contemporary photography, on behalf of His Highness, Their Excellencies, and everybody in this audience, thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good.